Okay, we're going to stand and sing our congregational song first today.
Yeah, this is easy. This is easy. Go ahead and stand up and let's do it. It's really easy song. You don't have to look at the words. I'll sing the verses. You guys help me with the chorus, or if you know the verses, please sing with me. This is a beautiful song. Talks about wanting to be of service in the most wonderful way. Ready, Brent? Use me. Yeah. Free reign, scary as that may be. What were they thinking? Some of you know that I'm working with little kids right now, and it's kind of been a challenge. Do you know how much energy they have? I'd never seen that before. It's almost scary, but I love it. One of the tunes that we have done, let me just pull this up for myself, sorry, while we're talking. Just a minute here. I release and I let go. And it's one of those songs that is so important to remember whenever adversity is there. You know, I let go of this, right? I let go of this and I'm there. So this is I release and I let go. And you can sing where you are. You can stand with me if you want to. I release, Brent. Yeah.
Would you like to open us now and go deep now that our energy's gone broad to go deep? Yeah.
Good morning. Well, it's a little hard to settle in after all that energy. But I invite you to turn within to that beautiful space within you that recognizes the power and the presence of the one spirit that guides us, the spirit that moves us and has its being through us. We're full of that God stuff that just emanates and carries us through the day. And I know that as we join together and as we acknowledge that presence within us, this service is unfolding with perfection, with excitement and energy, and the music is uplifting, and it is quieting, and it is perfect in every way. And I know that the message today is inspiring, and it's going to move through us as each part of this service unfolds. I am so grateful to be here with you today. I'm grateful to be praying with you and to see your beautiful faces. Your energy is flowing through me. I feel it right now. With gratitude in my heart for all that is unfolding, for all that is perfect, for all that is in this space with us right now, I release this word into the law, knowing it is done as spoken and through grace so much more. And please join me in saying, and so it is. And we have an affirmation. Please join me. My understanding of love allows me to remain conscious and aware of love's presence in my life and all life, all the time, in all ways, and I am thankful. And so it is.
And before we have our sacred reading, I just want to welcome everyone this morning. And did you notice it is fall?
Yes.
Yes. Officially and wet. So if you're here for the first time today and you didn't receive a packet, there's one out in the foyer. And please sign the book or leave your information for us so that we might keep in touch with you and let you know what all's going to, as we move into fall, there will be more and more things going on. So And take some time today and look at the announcements on the back of your program. And take that home with you and let you know what's happening. And also, next Sunday, of course, is Potluck Sunday. So be aware and prepared for that. And thank you, Darcy and Brent, for our wonderful music. And Reverend Don for our message today. And Catherine. Okay, do you hear that? There's a sign-up sheet for Potluck out there. So,
good morning. When I let go of what I am, I become what I might be. Lao Tzu. In other words, according to Grammarly, I become what I might be when I let go of what I am. Yes, I typed this all up, and Grammarly corrected it for me. I thought that was pretty funny. God can become to the individual only what God can become through the individual. Ernest Holmes. I heard a commencement speaker share something her grandfather encouraged her to develop, a soft focus. She described this as an old hunting term, meaning the wise hunter understood that things were constantly moving. In this way, you become adaptive to your environment, your reflexes in greater sync with the movement all around. She found this to be accurate as she reflected on her life as physician, CEO, and university president. She shared how everything she thought she was going to do did not unfold according to her plan. How true is that for most of us? Her grandfather's words saved her multiple times from the rigidity of expectation and being overcome by disappointment and heartache. Humans tend to build cultures of careful. The saying, fool me once, shame on you, fool me twice, shame on me, sustains this culture. Over time, it slowly diminishes the innocence and acceptance vital for space and rebirth. We become unconscious to the degree of our mental rigidity. For example, we arrive at conclusions about others based on unpleasant, hurtful memories. We draw conclusions about who they are. We keep a firm aim on this characterization with no consideration for their possible growth. When we consider the reversal of this action, people defining us based on old behaviors and actions, we begin to comprehend the failings of such unbending portrayals. Kurt Vonnegut said, "Be soft. Do not let the world make you hard." The degree to which we resist seeing growth in others is the degree to which we can't see it for ourselves. Take your eyes off the world and redirect focus on yourself. Let your personal criticisms receive an evolved form of attention, a softer, more fluid, and fuller focus of compassion for the entirety of your journey. And today's bonus affirmation, I am one with the rhythm of life. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. Those readings are always so amazing from Science of Mind magazine. And now Darcy and Brent.
Yeah. One of the things I've learned, let me just say that right. One of the things I know, and I'm still working on, is that love is one of those things that you need to give in a real and conscious way. It's easy to say, oh, I love you. It's much harder to say, I love you. And if you try that, just for grins, turn to the person next to you, just for fun, or someone, and say, I love you.
I love you.
I love you. An interesting It's so funny how you do that, and immediately people go, right? As opposed to, I love you, where people go, yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a funny thing. Being real and conscious and connecting with that in them makes it real for you. And so this song, though it is a secular song, brought that into reality. This is called L.O.V.E. And this is in my favorite style. This is a little jazz thing. So if you feel like it, have fun.
Do we love Darcy and Brent? Do we? Yes, we do. Oh, my golly. Whew. Oh, my goodness gracious sakes alive. We've gotten started. I was just going to start out by saying, before we get started, we're going to do something, but we are already started. But anyhow, before we get started on the message of the morning, Since our message of this morning still is exploring the subject of love, I want to honor the subject of romantic love. And then get it out of the way for our deeper subject of divine spiritual love, our human journey love, that kind of stuff. So to do this, I'm going to ask three of our Woodland Chapel researchers of love, capable people of loving relationship, who volunteered to help me on the subject of romantic love. They're going to share some humorous perspectives regarding romantic love. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with our reader of the morning, Catherine Kim will come forward. And then before she does that, the next one is going to be Reverend Julie Applegate, who's the host of today. And then as our anchor person of love, we'll have Shannon, our roving reporter, do her shtick there. So first, Catherine.
You know that tingly little feeling you get when you feel romantic towards someone?
Oh, well,
Yes. That is your common sense leaving your body. And another humorous but wise suggestion. Love at first sight is possible, and it pays to take a second look.
Good advice. Oh, thank you, Catherine. Thank you, thank you. Now, Reverend, you had something on your mind there. What was that?
I like that common sense leaving your body. So, a frank, straightforward statement humorously talks of falling in love with these words: "He stole my heart, so I'm planning on revenge." And I'm going to keep his last name, whoever thought of that, and keep it on the credit cards in my purse. Yeah. And another jab at romantic love asks the question and then answers the question. It asks, what is love? Love is the seventh sense that destroys all the other six senses and it makes a person believe in nonsense. Deeply researched.
Thank you. I think. One more. Have Shannon. Yeah, Shannon, you got a couple things.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's kick Julie off the stage.
Kicked you.
A lot of research going on here.
A lot of research, they said.
Well, Reverend Don, I ran across a question that asks, how can you tell if you are really in love or just having a crush? Based on a recent psychological study, a crush lasts for a minimum of 4 seconds. I'm sorry, 4 months. 4 months.
4 months.
But if you are talking to your love interest, man or woman, after that time, and you are still looking down at your phone, and you walk into a pole, well, that's a little bit more than a crush.
That's a disaster.
I also found this tidbit of wisdom. Now, this is important. This is really wise. Consider this. I trust you is better than I love you. So why is that? Because you can't always trust the one you love, but you could always trust, you could always love the one you trust. Do you find that confusing? I don't. Yes, okay.
That's
and last, last but not least, and I wish I would have done this many, many, many years ago. What is the worst thing a man can hear from the woman who is breaking up their love affair? What? So,
let her
okay,
finish.
You read this. Okay, it's when she says, it's not you, it's me. I just have horrible taste in men. Ba-dum-bum. And that's all, folks. Back to you, Reverend Don.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, lady. Great research. Great research that you've done on those. We'll be taking no questions from the audience on that. Okay. Well, let's see. We're out of music for a moment, aren't we?
It's your, you're on stage. Here it goes.
Have you got another song you can do for us real quick? No. Okay. Okay, here's the thing. We've come to our last Sunday of a month. All this year, every year, the whole year, each Sunday message was, you know, a part of what was called the monthly theme. And so we've had this theme all this month. Can anyone remember what that is?
Love.
But it says love out loud. Love out loud. That's the actual theme. Now, to me, that's asking me to not be silent about this mighty power of love. You knew love had power, I'm sure, yeah. To say something and do something about this love that reveals the truth about the power of love. You see, the power of love has been described as the glue that holds life together. That's one way of describing it. Life in all of its many forms, because the glue, I call it divine adhesive. The divine adhesive, if that love were not present, you know, life would not have a foundation or a meaning or a purpose or a togetherness or any of that. It would be scattered. It'd be confusing. It'd be blown hither and thither on the winds of change. You know, there's always change in the world, blows upon us, just like scattered leaves in the wind. Love is the glue that holds life together. And you know, we then do have meaning and develop purpose for our life. So let your love live out loud. Thank you. How do you like that for a talk? Oh, well, there's just a little bit more. I want to go to Marianne Williamson. Y'all know who Marianne Williamson is? Oh, yeah. Isn't she running for president? Or what?
Yeah.
Again? Yeah, okay. Well, in her book, her early book called A Return to Love, remember that one? Okay. She makes this sweet, insightful proclamation that our conscious, mindful returning to love in our lives is, it reconnects us to our strength of our true spirit. That's the true part of us, that innermost curiosity of our heart's desires to see and understand our world and discover our place in the world. That's what we're trying to do all the time, are we not? We're trying to establish or confirm, or discover, who am I? Where am I? Why do I come? What am I here for? Isn't that a great song when we sing that sometimes about why were you born? Why did you come to earth? All that, and it starts answering that. To love, serve, and remember. Yeah, I love that. You know, we are a species. We want to believe in miracles. We just want to believe in miracles. And there are moments when we relish the mundane, you know, becoming miraculously full of joy, joyful because we feel it's a miracle. But the usual way life works weighs in with the facts of life all the time, right there in front of us. You see, brand new days, every new morning, every new day, with our, it has our personal impress on it. We wake up, but we're personally influencing it right then. Our habitual thinking takes over. Our habits of steeping ourselves, oh, this is a good one. Steeping ourselves in all the world chatter blasting in from us in all directions. We have so many instruments of connection and communication nowadays, many miraculously helpful, you know, of course. But here's something very, I think, impacting on our life for us to consider. I wrote this down, so I don't want to make a mistake in how I tell you about it. This is a truth I'm going to give you. At the beginning of the day, it is a fact, the mind is most open to receive brand new impressions. And one of the most important things we can do is just take our full responsibility for what I call the flow of the power of the morning when we're fresh. But if we want to have an anxiety, stress-ridden day, I suggest that the iPad, the radio, the TV, or the newspaper, and the caffeine form the crux of our morning regimen, as it does so often. And just listen to the morning news while in the shower, maybe. Get those carefully designed headlines read, pummeling our senses with warnings, the wars going on, the life falterings and arguments of politics going on, and the celebrities' lives that are tempting us and luring us going on. Stay immersed and stay informed. Everything. Take it in. Inundated with the sensational and clucking, head-shaking news, some of it, easily found in our sources of staying informed. We've got all ways to do that. Do any of you guys remember a tabloid? It was popular for years. I don't see it much anymore. It was on the grocery check stands you go through, and there's a TV guide right there, you know, for telling you all about this, all this TV you can watch. But it's called the National Enquirer. It's still around, okay? All right. Well, I don't see it very often. You know, I don't see it very often now, but it used to be right there. It's also calling for us to check out 24/7. No, it isn't. The National Choir has a slogan. Anybody know what it is?
Inquiring minds
wants to know. Needs to know. Wants to know. Absolutely. Trying to best allure our attention, trying to make our senses just water for juicy gossip on the famous and the rich and not so famous or whatever. Now, most readers were probably taken in by the salacious gossip style it could lure us with. But it can all be in fun if you don't take it seriously. You know, my wife and I still take a newspaper. Anybody here still take a newspaper? Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Online, yeah, online, see, yes, okay. Well, we take the newspaper, you know. but not the National Enquirer, we haven't done that yet. You can get a subscription to that, someone told me. And I confess, while drinking my first cup of tea for the day, I enjoy the comics. Does anyone else do the comics? Ah, look at that thumbs up back here. Ooh, yeah, okay, I enjoy the comics. And I got a good guffaw out of... I think it was midweek it came up, but it was one about Dagwood and Blondie. Does anybody not, yeah. Anybody not know Dagwood and Blondie? Like, I tell you, what I want to know is how they go on year after year and never get any older. It's just Blondie looks like she's 25 years old and she's got teenage kids graduating from high school. Got to figure like, wow, Blondie. Anyhow, in this newspaper, I was reading the comic. There's Dagwood and Blondie sitting at their kitchen table. And both of them, piece of the paper, not looking at each other, but Dagwood lowers his paper to look at Blondie. And he says, I can't believe all the great crazy stuff that's going on in the world today. And she's still reading. She says, what's that, dear? And he says, well... You know what I'm talking about. She says, I know what you're talking about. And he says, there's only one thing that makes any sense anymore. What's that, dear? He says, the comics. And she says, absolutely. And I said, heck yeah, that's right. Let's go right on with the rest of them here. There's BC and everything else. You know, what would you do without the comics, you know, when you think about it? There was a whole article in today's paper about how comics have influenced our culture. Yeah, it's amazing. Anyhow, you know, I want to make a point, is why I brought that up. Most of us wouldn't think of beginning our day without taking a shower or washing our face, washing the accumulated dirt from the day before, whatever you want to call it, off our bodies. Many take that morning shower and then put on our public face. However, far too often we go out into the day without similarly cleansing and freshening our minds.
you know, so that we can share loving ways for others with others in our world. Most teachers of spiritual living tell us that, you know, we ought to consider that our minds carry more pollution than our bodies. Yeah. For our minds carry not only our own toxicity, but that of the entire world. We carry the fears and the anxieties and the anger and the stresses and the pain, not just of our own lives, but our families and our nation and millions of other people, the immigrants, everything. Love cannot grow or flourish or nourish or nurture or sustain the national beauty that just is natural. To have this now. It's a natural beauty and it's spontaneous and it's a happiness that divine has got in store for us that we just go right on by and don't even see it in the morning sometimes or the whole day. If we don't have a clean mind and a willing heart to receive love, we don't have a lot. The divine mind is ready, if we're told this, to furnish the love of God in everything we do. And I believe that. I believe that. The older I get, and I'm not a spring chicken anymore. I'm an old rooster. But all the grace and the goodness of spirit can only flourish and flow through a mind gate that we hold the key to. Yeah, we hold the key. We were given this keys to the kingdom of divine love, whose code to unlock that treasures of divine love, they're found in our gift. The gift that we were born with, that we were given, and this makes us what we are as humanity. It's a gift of our mind. Your mind. My mind in the one mind of the divine mind. Nothing stands in our way except that what we hold in our thoughts, in our mind. Nothing except our thoughts. That's why our class that we're teaching is so exciting. Change our thinking. Change our life. Yeah. That's a great class. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for bringing it to our attention, Reverend Julie. You know, Marianne Williamson in her book, Returning to Love, promises that we need not let fear steal our mornings or the day's beginnings. We just have to understand that we have the power, that gift, that's a good way of putting it, in our human beingness of just who we are, to consciously choose not to allow our minds to be programmed by the worldly viewpoints. Those viewpoints that dominate the earth. They do. And there's a difference between being informed and being influenced. There's a difference. Yeah, we're swimming. We're swimming in collective consciousness. We've talked about this before. We're talking about this over and over again. But thanks to our power of choosing, of choice, we can tune in to another radio station. Hey, we like our radio station here at Wooden Chapel. Call letters L-O-V-E. L-O-V-E. Yeah. Call it. Yeah. We can turn the dial in our minds, only if you decide to do so. Our class for that next 5 weeks is going to really cover that. So we have this great possibility using our mind to start with empowerment intentions. The empowering intentions. For me, what I do is I take a walk or a short bicycle ride, if the weather permits, when I get up in the morning, and I affirm and I treat with each step as I go along. I'm talking to myself. Hey, you talking to me? I'm talking to myself. I'm talking to God. Yeah, my God self. Speaking words of power. I try to speak words of power, not like working on my problems. So how am I going to do? No, I don't want to think about how am I going to try to do something. I want to accept the power that's coming to me right there. And by the time I get back home, then I get Phyllis awake and up for her shower, and then I relax with a cup of tea and the comics. Yeah, sets it all in place. And then some breakfast and then ready for the day. Yeah, talking to myself. That helps me influence the rest of my day's activities. And things are always calling me to duty, I find. To duty. And duty, I've outlined it or defined it for myself. It's simply just answering those things that I need to do. That's my duty. Absolutely. So I get out and I move my booty and I get going. I make it work. But first, if I don't take my special to be what I must be, and get that sense of love enfolding me. That's what it is. The love of God permeates the universe, permeates everything in it, permeates all life, permeates the power, permeates me right here now. All of that holds in me so near and dear, enfolding me. All of those words that empower me that I've come to believe, if I don't take that, then I get that sense of that love enfolding me. If I just hop onto the doing the day just right away, it's not the same. I don't prepare myself for the day first. That's what I find anyhow. You may have it different. You may be able to get up and get it in gear and get going. That's wonderful. But we don't live in a vacuum, you know. We do swim in shark-infested waters at times. I realize that. Yeah. But our minds are so preciously, powerfully ready for us to use purposefully, with purpose and meaning, instead of throwing open the door to ourselves and just jumping on the train of the world, scrambling right away in the morning, first thing as we awake. With love, we can choose to practice peaceful intentions, loving intentions, wakeful to the spiritual possibilities of the day. We use words like that a lot here, spiritual, mindful. Most of you know what that means, you know. I have a good friend, a pastor of the Baptist Church up in Portland. His awakening is every morning, read that Bible, because it has power for him, gives him insights to where he's going. Well, we have that to use also if we want to. So, for now, as we move through this morning, I'd like to bring this to our attention. The news of the world struggles, they're not lying to us about all that suffering and struggling people and the evil appearing destruction all over the world. No, we're not being misled. In all that, it's totally understandable for us to ask ourselves a question. You see, it seems as if a mysterious force is moving through the world where some people are assigned to terrible misery and suffering while others live in such abundance and ease. Now, why is that, is the question. It's okay to ask that question. Many religions, you know, claim to answer that question. Some go so far as to say it's God's will. Another is about children dying of hunger or people having to live in war-torn regions. I've actually heard people say, oh, well, that's their karma. Just as if that's the end of the conversation. But I think that's an astonishing way of lacking genuine compassion and avoiding the responsibility of bearing witness to human suffering. That's what it is. Avoiding bearing witness to human suffering. Not turning our eyes away, but bearing witness and allowing a fostering in us of a deeper compassion, understanding that anything can fuel the fires of compassion and radical love, even bearing witness to suffering. If our hearts are wide open enough, even the most horrific situations can increase within us actually in the capacity to love. The story of Sister Teresa is so inspirational. Sister Teresa, holding the dying body of a street person where a doctor sees disease and death, Sister Teresa sees God. My, oh my. That inspires me. And for good news, reading in the Science of Mind textbook, the teachings in it proclaims this. Oh, this is a good one. It says in our text, it says, the world is beginning to realize that it has learned all it should by now through the suffering and the pain. It doesn't say we have all learned that lesson, but it says we should by now be getting the message. Yeah. It's challenging to see that God or love, the other name many of us give to God, it's ours to do, however, to see that in everything. Our duty is in the face of all our challenges for our personal lives in the world to know and hold faith that love is the answer. That's just not a slogan. If love is not the answer, listen, if it's not the answer, then to cultivating a world that can work for all creatures, then if not, why do we say God is love and God is all there is? Why are we going to say that? That's not meant to be a Pollyanna perspective. Dang, no. But it does come down to love and compassion in the face of our bearing witness to human suffering and pain. You see, the universe doesn't sweep anything under a rug, a cosmic rug. You know what it does? It incorporates. It incorporates. It has use for everything, including the human conditions. Every last fraction, an atom of what we are, the we, the you, the me, every human being on the planet, each of us has this power of love abiding within our divine soul self. We were born with it. We were born with it. And then the world started our cultivation, our education in the world's ways. We have to learn how to get along in this world, yeah. But this power of love is still within us, awaiting our recognition and use. Now, let me put it this way. Even if there's nothing we specifically think we can do to help our suffering neighbor, there is spiritual power remaining awake in us to witness with them, for them, in their hours of agony. You see, let me cover that. In bearing witness to human suffering, I think it means to not turn away from seeing. And it's humanly okay to be affected. You know, we want to guard ourselves. Yeah, it's okay to be affected by what we see. It is vital to love's involvement for us to not become infected. There's a difference there, too. There's a comfort in knowing our affection to become our intention for compassion. This is where the power of love really shines. The light, like a candle of called compassion in the dark that illumines the most painful night of any soul. Compassion takes care of that. That's love. The mystic in you and me, the mystic that we are, that part of us, we know that. We know that's love, that love is the answer. All of us in our own way, just by being a little more tender, a little more loving, we can open our hearts and make a difference in someone's life. The transforming power of empathy, not just sympathy. There's a difference there too. Sympathy is bleeding with others' pain. Empathy is powerful love. Understand, a loving understanding. That's empathy. I'd like to start winding down here with a brief reading and sharing from the book that's titled Everyday Grace. That's Marianne Williamson's. Here's what she writes. I really like this. The beautiful face of love can be seen in our compassion. Compassion is not just emotion. It is a force. It is an aspect of the infinite power of God love. And what do we teach? God is love. Humanity's next great leap in consciousness will be the realization that love is a power to be applied, no less than the power of steam, the power of electricity, no less than the power of the atom. What an extraordinary burst of light could pervade the world atmosphere should a shift in consciousness from narrow self-obsession that the world has and narcissism in so many folk giving way to compassion and be a common everyday miracle among us. At what point does the heart burst open and commit to something, doing something, anything, if it will possibly make a difference in easing the pain of someone else? There's a point where you go past, there's no turning back. You know, there were ages when people sat on great powers, you know, didn't know how to harness them for practical purposes. We knew there was atomic energy before we knew how to split the atom. We knew that. And in a simple example, I'll give you something here, just more easier to understand. People enjoyed this beauty of the Niagara Falls long before its hydroelectric power lit entire cities from its movement to harness the moving waters. We know there's love in the human heart. We know there is. We feel it, we give it, We experience it. At times we'll say, it, love, sets us on fire. Oh, yeah. Love has its ignition points. And like fire, it consumes. Yeah, we can be consumed by love. It can consume us, but it can also transform us. Here's the beauty. We have only to begun really just to scratch the surface of how we can use love to restore and transform the world. It's the task that we have of our generation, I think, and all generations to come, to set the tone, widen the path for love, and guide it into becoming a social force. That's the only way it'll work for everyone, to make a world that works for everyone. Marianne Williamson, I'll quote her, says this. She says, I believe the most significant development of the 21st century must be the harnessing of the social potential of love. Now, some last comments. Does anyone here speak French? How do I pronounce Pierre de Jardin? Is that close enough? Yes, yeah, Jardin, Pierre. You know, he, along with many others, have said that the discovery or the striking use of fire was one of the great scientific and technological discoveries of all human history. Because fire, to this, a great extent, made human civilization possible, and it continues. Fire made our human social evolution possible, even. There was no Bronze Age without fire. There was no Iron Age without fire. No Industrial Revolution without fire. Those of us who came in here in cars this morning, even fire makes it possible. Controlled, harnessed fire. Fire makes it possible for us to text and tweet and email and Instagram and Facebook and actually be dysfunctional with each other. Socially dysfunctional. Fire, in various combined ways, makes all that possible. And here's our great calling. Chardin said, fire was one of the greatest discoveries in all of human history. And then he went on to say, if humanity ever harnesses the energy of love, it'll be the second time in history that we have discovered fire. Amen. And so it is. Thank you. All right.
Please don't let this feeling end. It's everything I am, everything I want to be. I can see what's mine now, finding out what's true. Since I found you, looking through the eyes of love, now I can take the time, I can see my life as it comes up, shining now.
What a powerful, powerful morning all the way around. Thank you so much. Real heart moving day. Yeah. So I would ask some ushers to come forward. And for those who are watching online and you can participate with us also in the sharing of our goods, our time, our talent, our love. And so let us say together, and perhaps you have that memorized at home, divine love moving through, in and through me, blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Thank you, God. It's a little bit different than it was before. Yeah. And so we know that there are power in our words and in our thoughts. And as we send them forth into the law of mind, they return to us. And there is power in blessing. So I'd ask you just to put your hands over your heart this morning as we just bless these gifts. We bless you, the giver. And we know that in this universe, God is our source. And so we need not fear as we get in alignment with that power. We are blessed and multiplied in every way in our life. There is abundance everywhere. So as we affirm that and know that and make it a part of our very consciousness, the riches overflow. The riches overflow. And so I speak my word of blessing this morning for the gifts, the givers, and for this community, and for all, as we embrace all in love. And so it is. And so let us stand this morning and say our prayer of protection together, and then our peace song, of course, of course. And we sing the words of peace, knowing that peace is possible. Peace is possible. And so the light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.